القرآن يوحدنا لطريق الخير يوجهنا الله تعالى أنزله ورسول الله معلمنا.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سورة المنافقون, the hypocrites. This is also a Madinan surah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذا جاءك المنافقون قالوا نشهد إنك لرسول الله والله يعلم إنك لرسوله والله يشهد إن المنافقون لكاذبون. When the hypocrites come to you, they say, we bear witness that you are indeed the messenger of Allah. Allah knows that you are indeed His messenger, and Allah bears witness that the hypocrites are liars. So the hypocrites, whenever they came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they had to pose, they had to put on this big show that they were very good Muslims, very sincere Muslims. Why did they do that? Because of the guilty feeling in their heart. They knew that in their hearts they hated Islam. They hated Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They hated the Muslims. And this is the sign of a hypocrite, that a hypocrite is happy to see the Muslims losing, that Islam losing, and he loves to see the non-Muslims defeating the Muslims. So this, if that is the condition in somebody's heart, then that makes a person a hypocrite. So Allah says the hypocrites used to come to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say, we bear witness that you are the messenger of Allah. Allah knows that you are indeed His messenger, and Allah bears witness that the hypocrites are liars. They use their oaths as a shield and thus debar others from the way of Allah. Evil indeed is what they do. They are using their oaths as a shield to protect themselves, because had they not said that they were Muslims, they were scared that they will be killed by the Muslims. And so in order to protect themselves, they embraced Islam. They used to say, we are Muslim. They would read their prayers with the Muslims, fast with the Muslims, be in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in their hearts, they were not with the Muslims. This is because they believed and then renounced their faith. Their hearts are sealed, therefore they are devoid of understanding. When you see them, their good stature pleases you, and when they speak, you listen to what they say. They have very beautiful bodies. They are very impressive. They have very impressive personalities. When you look at them, you are highly impressed by them. And when they listen, then people, when they speak, then people listen to what they say, because they have a very fake and a very impressive style of speaking. So these are worldly people. They love to impress others through their speech, through their physical look, etc. Yet they are as worthless as hollow pieces of propped up timber. If we take a piece of wood and just prop it up against the wall, what good is that wood to anybody? That good is worth more if it is the part of a tree, then it can bear fruit, it can give shade, it can do so many things. But if that piece of timber is cut off and put up on a wall, what good is it except for beautifying that wall? So this is the condition of the hypocrites. Superficially, they are very beautiful. They give, people are impressed by their looks. However, inside there is nothing, no iman. Every shout they hear, they think it to be against them because of their guilty conscience. They are your enemies, so guard yourselves against them. May Allah destroy them. How perverse they are. When it is said to them, come, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will pray for your forgiveness, they shake their heads, and you see them turning away with arrogance. It is the same whether you pray for their forgiveness or not. Allah is not going to forgive them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was to pray for their forgiveness, Allah is not going to forgive these people. Why not? Why are they the worst of creation? Because if a person is a disbeliever, he is a clear enemy. Others can take precaution from him. But these hypocrites, they are hidden enemies. People think them to be their friends, their own kind. Yet inside they are not their friends, rather they are their enemies. So they are actually trying to deceive the Muslims. So Allah says, whether it is the same, whether you pray for their forgiveness or not, Allah is not going to forgive them. Surely Allah does not guide the transgressors. They are the same people who say, do not give anything to those who follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam until they have deserted him. So this was one strategy that Abdullah bin Ubay and his followers employed. They said, if you do not give any sadaqah to these people, then they will eventually have to go away. They will go back to Makkah. So they were trying to employ this strategy. هُمُ الَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ لَا تُنْفِقُوا عَلَى مَنْ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَنْفَدُّوا وَلِلَّهِ خَزَائِنُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them, to Allah belong the treasures of the heavens and the earth, but the hypocrites cannot understand this. Meaning they think that it is just their sadaqahs which are keeping these Muslims going. It is just their aid that is keeping these Muslims going. And if they cut off their aid, then the Muslims are going to just disappear from the face of this earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all treasures of the heavens and the earth belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the hypocrites do not understand this. They say, when we return to Medina, the honorable will soon drive out the meaner. But the honor belongs to Allah, to His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to the disbelievers. But the hypocrites do not know this. This actually was said after the Ghazwa Banu Mustaliq, and this was said by Abdullah bin Ubay. He said, when we go back to Medina, then the honorable amongst us, he was referring to his own self, will drive out the meaner. And that he was referring to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abdullah bin Ubay's own son Abdullah, he was a staunch Muslim. When he heard that, when the people went back to Medina, he told his father, you cannot enter Medina. I will not allow you to enter Medina. But then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam intervened, and the matter was settled, and the father was allowed to enter. So Abdullah bin Ubay had said this, when we return to Medina, the honorable will soon drive out the meaner. But the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but the honor belongs to Allah, to His Messenger, and to the believers. But the hypocrites do not know this. Who is honorable in the sight of Allah? It is those who are obedient to Allah's commandments, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those who are following him. They are the ones who are the honorable ones in the sight of Allah. O believers, let neither your riches nor your children divert you from the remembrance of Allah. Two things keep people away from Allah's work. What is that? Children and wealth. People are so involved in their jobs, in their business, or women are so involved with their children and domestic chores that sometimes they don't even have time for prayers. Astaghfirullah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning against that. O believers, do not let your riches or your children divert you from the remembrance of Allah. Those who will do so, it is they who shall be the real losers. Spend in charity and in the cause of Allah out of the sustenance which we have bestowed on you before that time when death will come to any one of you. And he shall say, O my Lord, if only you'd give me respite for a little while, then I would give out everything in charity and be among the righteous. But Allah grants respite to no soul when its term comes to an end. Allah is well aware of all your actions. So Allah is warning us, وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ فَيَقُولَ رَبِّي لَوْلَا أَخَّرْتَنِي إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ قَرِيبٍ فَأَصَّدَّقَ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرَ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهَا وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when the time of anyone comes, when the time of death comes, then there is no going back. So while we have been given this opportunity, while we are still alive, it is best to give as much sadaqah as possible in Allah's way, to do as many good deeds as possible for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the Sahaba ikram, do you know who is, and the gist of his hadith is, do you know who is a pauper from amongst my ummah? And the Sahaba ikram said, somebody who doesn't have dinars and dirhams. He said, no. The pauper from my ummah is the one who will come on the day of resurrection with a lot of rewards for his lot of prayers and zakat and fasting, and he had done so much. But he had been mean to somebody, he had killed somebody, he had been abusive to somebody, meaning he had done these things, he had not given people their rights. So what's going to happen that day? Those people will come and take away his good deeds until he's left with nothing. And when he runs out of good deeds, then, and still he has people's rights to pay off, then other people's evil deeds, their sins, will be taken and loaded onto him. So such a person, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is the pauper from amongst the Ummati Muslimah. Surah At-Taghabun is also a Madinan surah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Yusabbihu lillahi ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard lahul mulku wa lahul hamd wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. All that is in the heavens and the earth glorifies Allah. To him belongs the kingdom and to him is due all praise. He has power over all things. It is he who has created you. Yet of you are the disbelievers and some are believers. Allah is observant of all your actions. He created the heavens and the earth to manifest the truth. He shaped you and shaped you well, and to him you shall all return. He knows all that is in the heavens and the earth. He knows what you conceal and what you reveal. How can we hide anything from Allah? Allah knows everything about us inside out. And Allah knows what is in your heart. Have you not heard of those who disbelieved before you? So they tasted the evil result of their deeds. And in the hereafter, there shall be a painful punishment for them. That is because when their messengers came to them with clear revelation, they said, are human beings going to guide us? So this is how they forgot the message and they started picking on the messenger. This is the condition of many people. When they want to hear something from the Quran and Sunnah, they want to know who is teaching. And if they don't like the personality or the style, or they don't like the person's way or anything about this person, then they will deprive themselves of the benefit that could have come to them had they listened to the Quran and Sunnah. Because it is the message which should be focused upon, not the person who is delivering the message. And this was the condition of the people who did not want to believe. Their objection was, are human beings going to guide us? So they disbelieved and they paid no heed. Allah has no need of such people. Allah is free of all needs, worthy of all praise. The disbelievers claim that they shall not be raised to life again. Tell them, indeed, by my Lord, you shall surely be raised to life again. Then you shall be told of all that you have done, and that is easy for Allah. Therefore, believe in Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the light which we have revealed. فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَالنُّورِ الَّذِي أَنزَلْنَا وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. Allah says, believe in Allah, believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the light which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down, which is the Quran. Allah is well aware of all your actions. يَوْمَ يَجْمَعُكُمْ لِيَوْمِ الْجَمْعِ ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ التَّغَابُنِ. The day when he will gather you all will be the day of assembly, the day of gathering, which shall be the day of gain and loss for the people. Some will be the losers and some will be those who will stand to gain. Like the pauper, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, he is going to come with a lot of good deeds, thinking now he'll gain so many rewards. But because he had not been good to people, he had not given the rights of people, the people will take away all his good deeds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the day of gain and loss. ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ التَّغَابُنِ. Those who believe in Allah and do good deeds, He will remove from them their sins and admit them to gardens beneath which rivers flow, to live in it forever. And that will be the supreme achievement. As for those who disbelieved and deny our revelations, they will become the inmates of hell, wherein they shall live forever, and that is an evil abode. Alladhina kafaru wa kazzabu bi ayatina ulaika ashabun nar ashabun nari khalidina fiha wa bi'sal masir. Ma asaba min musibatin illa bi idhnillah wa man yu'min billahi yahdi qalbah. Wallahu bi kulli shayin aleem. No affliction can ever befall except by the leave of Allah. He that believes in Allah, his heart is guided to the right way. So this is a basic tenet of our faith, a basic tenet of Iman, to know firmly that whatever happens to us, good or bad, it had to happen. There was no way that it could have been avoided. Why? Because it was already written in our fate by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ma saba min musibatin illa bi idhnillah. No affliction can ever befall except by the leave of Allah. So it is Allah's decree. And when we accept that this is the decree of Allah, Allah had made this happen and this was going to happen, there was no avoiding it, then it prevents man from a lot of negative emotions. If man accepts the decree of Allah, then his heart becomes tranquil. He becomes a sabir and he accepts Allah's decree. He that believes in Allah, his heart is guided to the right way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ يَهْدِي قَلْبَهُ. Allah is going to guide his heart towards tranquility and peace, even though the person may be facing a lot of problems in life, but in his heart there is peace and tranquility because he knows that what has happened to him, there was no way that it could have been avoided. And that is why we have been taught to make that dua after our prayers. O Allah, whatever you choose to give, nobody can take it away from us. And whatever you do not choose to give us, then nobody can give it to us. Allah has the knowledge of everything. Obey Allah and obey His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if you pay no heed, then you should know that our Messenger's responsibility is only to convey the message plainly. That is the job of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now it is up to us. Whether we believe in the message, if we act on the message, it's totally up to us. Allah, there is no God but He. Therefore, in Allah alone, let the believers put their trust. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, inna min azwajikum wa awladikum aduwwan lakum fahdharuhum, wa in ta'fu wa tasfahu wa taghfiru fa inna allaha ghafurun rahim. O believers, surely among your wives and your children, there are some who are your enemies, so beware of them. But if you pardon, overlook and forgive their faults, then Allah is forgiving and merciful. Your wealth and your children are but a trial. Innama amwalukum wa auladukum fitnatun wallahu indahu ajrun azim. Your wealth and your children are but a trial. It is Allah with whom is the greatest reward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever blessings He has blessed us with, whether the blessings are in the form of our children or our spouse or wealth or comforts of life or peace of mind, everything that Allah has blessed us with is a trial and a test for us. Sometimes people, for the sake of their children, for the sake of their families, they do wrong things in life. Why? Because they want to keep their children happy, they want to meet all the desires of their children and family. So they take bribes, they become corrupt, and they get indulged in sin, and they do all kinds of wrong things. Why? So that they can keep their children and wives happy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about such families, among your wives and your children, there are some who are your enemies, so beware of them. Allah is warning the people, do not do wrong things, do not commit sins just for the sake of your children and family. Rather, think what is right in the eyes of Allah and do that only. A life of moderation is the best life to lead. Aisha radiallahu anha says that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be busy in household chores, but as soon as the azan came in his ears, he would become like a stranger. He would go to read his prayers and then he didn't care about anybody around him. So this shows us the beautiful balance in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which Allah wants us also to emulate. Sometimes young mothers, when they are praying, even during their prayers, their mind is not free. They are continuously thinking what their children are doing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to have a balance in life. When we are doing our ibadat, we should only be doing thinking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should do it with khushu and khudu. And we should never do anything which is displeasing to Allah, whether it is for the sake of our children or our spouse. So Allah says, surely among your wives and your children, there are some who are your enemies, so beware of them. But if you pardon, overlook and forgive their faults, then Allah is forgiving and merciful. Meaning, how should we behave with our families? Allah says, pardon them. Because our families, we are dealing with them all the time, 24/7. And if a person is going to be angry and upset at their faults, then he is never going to be a happy person. So Allah is teaching us with our families, keep on pardoning them their faults. Of course, tell them what is the right thing, but don't keep grudges in the heart, don't remain angry with them. So Allah says, pardon them, overlook their faults and forgive their faults. Then Allah is forgiving and merciful. Allah will forgive you your faults. Your wealth and your children are but a trial. It is Allah with whom is the greatest reward. Therefore, fear Allah as much as you can. Listen to His message attentively. Be obedient and be charitable. This is for your own good. وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ نَفْسِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ Those who are saved from the greed of their own souls, it is they who are truly successful. Allah is again making it clear, do not be greedy. Meaning sometimes some people, they are only concerned about their own self-satisfaction, their own joys, their own entertainment. They are least bothered about anybody else. Then there's another category of people who are only concerned about the joy and comfort of their own families. Beyond that, they are least bothered whether their neighbor is starving or whether their neighbor is hungry. They are not bothered. Whether their colleagues are sad, whether their friends, their relatives are suffering, they are not bothered so long as everything is okay with them and their families. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who are saved from the greed of their own souls, it is they who are truly successful. So in order to succeed, one has to overcome this greed. One has to think about everybody. One has to be a well-wisher for everybody. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said, "Ad-deenun nasiha." Deen is well-wishing. A person has to be a well-wisher for everybody. If you lend to Allah a goodly loan, He will pay you back manyfold, and He will forgive you your sins. Allah is appreciative and forbearing to those who are grateful. He has the knowledge of the unseen and the seen. He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. إِن تُقْرِضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا يُدَاعِفْهُ لَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ شَكُورٌ حَلِيمٌ عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ Allah is again reminding the believers, those who give Allah a goodly loan. How can we give a loan to Allah? This is called qarz-e hasana. A loan given to Allah means giving something to promote the cause of Allah's deen. Allah considers that as a loan on Himself. And He will return this loan with its reward multiplies 10 to 700 times and even more if He desires. Which business venture? Or which institution can offer us this kind of profit? And yet people are not ready to put their money in this business venture to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, if you lend to Allah a goodly loan, He will pay you back manyfold. And He will forgive you your sins. Allah is appreciative and forgiving to those who are grateful. He has the knowledge of the unseen and the seen. And He is the Almighty, the All-Wise. عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمِ Let's take a shot.
هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ يُوَحِّدُنَا لِطَرِيقِ الْخَيْرِ يُوَجِّهُنَا اللَّهُ تَعَالَى